Dobro večer. Hvala lepo na pozivu. Drago mi je što među vam, ali žao mi je što ne mogu da govorim u Srbu. Therefore now in English. So, I'm very pleased to introduce that discussion, which is not easy. I'm respecting the title, that is the topics which was proposed to me, which means self-censorship. I will not speak of the past Yugoslavia. And the title is the Eastern Periphery of Europe within the global and European crisis. So first some comments on the notions used on the title. When we speak of periphery, and when I speak of periphery in my articles, or when the discussion will go on, it's not a geographical notion, as you must know. Well, it can be used in a geographical sense, but that is not the meaning I want to use. I want to use what was introduced as a concept by the historian Fernand Braudel, and still now used also by Wallerstein, Emmanuel Wallerstein, as an economist, Marxist economist, a concept which is a geopolitical concept to describe the capitalist. It was used to describe the historical genesis and development of the capitalist world system. World system was a part of the planet at the time, in the 19th century especially, with an expansion, but the concept of periphery was introduced in that analysis of relationship of domination within the capitalist world system, leading to a forced division of labor between core countries, which could be also called imperialist one in other approaches, of course, but not contradictory. So core country, which were dominant, industrialized or industrializing countries unable to control their way to become industrialized, through relationship of domination with the periphery in strict terms. It means colony. And semi-periphery was used to describe still relationship of domination and dependency between core country and what was called a semi-industrialized or semi-periphery, semi-industrialized country or semi-peripheries, saying they were no more colonies in the strict sense, because they had independent states. But still, they were dependent on financial capital, which existed already, and through also, of course, other means, including direct political and military relationships. So, of course, this kind of capitalist system was an historical period. There are phases, different periods. And I do believe this can be a matter of discussion with certain Marxists, but I do believe that the revolutions which occurred in the 20th century had for main roots and dynamics and causes the need to break with those relationship of domination, precisely to permit to break with a dependent form of industrialization, which de facto was submitted to the needs of the core countries. That is industrialization, which was aiming at solving the question of profit and of also finding new markets. for the core countries. And so those revolutions occurred in semi-peripheral countries, where the question of sovereignty did exist, but also the question of having the possibility of industrialization, breaking with that dependency from the core country. And I do believe that was the roots of the revolutions, and that there was a real period of not an absolute break, but a real break with that dependency. Of course, new other unforeseen issues, problems, conflicts within a new, let us speak of a new socialist or real socialist, as Will quotes, a world system with relationship of domination and conflicts existing within that specific world system, but of a different kind than from the strictly capitalist one. So, I'm not speaking of that, but that the question is that after the historical turning point of 1989-1991, that is the end of real socialism in precisely Eastern Europe, there was a new phase precisely of peripheralization through the capitalist restoration and of integration in the core system. In the recent period, to finish that introductory comment, in the recent period, especially after the Greek crisis and the terminology periphery has been used more and more to describe a south periphery, and often forgetting the eastern one. So I will concentrate on the eastern one. We can discuss precisely differences and common issues. But the question I want to raise for the debate is a question between two possible interpretation and possible combined interpretation, which I will propose to you. Is there a semi-peripherization, or is there, for Eastern European country, an integration in the core capitalist countries? So that is the two parts I will develop and introduce. Why can we speak of a real process of new, I would say, semi-peripherization, because there is not, in the absolute sense, a colonial, but semi- or neo-colonial possible kind of a relationship for Eastern Europe after 1989-1991. And the second part, the discussion, why is that formulation not completely satisfactory on my point of view, and even sometimes misleading? And I leave open to the discussion the consequences. But to illustrate the perception, when I was going in the beginning of the 90s in Eastern Europe, for instance in Poland, at the beginning of the 90s, there was a Polish intellectual which expressed the hope and beginning of disillusion in the following way, and with the following image, saying we from Eastern European countries, we were hoping to go towards the north, meaning developed core countries, and we are going towards the south. So that expressed the issue. A second formulation that I heard, a second image about the debate here, that I heard in Slovenia in the beginning of the 90s, was the following. It is better to be the last in the town, then the first in the village. The village being Yugoslavia. And if you are only the last in the town, the last doesn't mean a relationship of domination. So the formulation was expressing a hope to join the town that is the core country. And in Hungary, last example also of what I found traveling in the beginning of the 90s there, some of my leftist friends who were very critical towards, against capitalism, but they were saying, it was in the middle of the 90s, they were saying, well, we have been since 89 in a peripheral position, being outside the European Union. They were very critical to the European Union, it's non-democratic and so on and so forth, but they say, at least if we enter it, we could be in a better position to fight for rights. So that is that complex, what would all those three persons say today, 12 years later? That's also the question for the discussion. Anyway, the first part on the real new, it's not to say it's like in the 19th century, there is a new but semi-peripherization. I will illustrate it on three main aspects. The strength of external exogenous, how do you say that, factors and actors of the capitalist restoration, actors, external actors and factors. Secondly, the symmetries in the European construction, which is institutional, European Union and so on. And third, new financial and trade dependencies, real. So the three points, if it works, yes. So first, the strengths, the strength of external factors and actors in the capitalist restoration. I can be rapid because it's well known. I am not speaking, it can be a matter of a debate, of a conspiracy. But a real role of international financial institutions as a relationship of force, using a concrete vector, the debt. It was true also for the South countries, but in Eastern Europe there existed also, I don't go into detail, but for five countries, in the 80s, an external debt in foreign currency for the first time, which permitted to the IMF, International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and so on, and the new banks, which was established for so-called development and helping privatization, to influence very directly. Even the conditions of transformation. For the South country, the IMF used the conditioned credit to structural adjustment and change of society. It was much more radical for Eastern European countries. I have friends here who have experienced the direct role of the World Bank in the way to propose a new forms of accountabilities and so on and so forth, and experts coming through also all kind of mechanism and influence and so on explain what was the so-called Washington consensus, which under the formula is the summary of the different recipe that the international institution, financial institute, pushed forward in the world to transform the society in forced privatization. Stalin organized forced collectivization. Here it was forced and generalized privatization. And of course the European Union came later on, the European Commission came later than the World Bank and those financial institutions, but using not the debt but the criteria of integration within the Union, like the International Monetary Fund. It was more or less the same Washington consensus to be implemented de facto to impose generalized privatization. Generalized privatization, which means also generalized, well, so-called transition to market economy, a formulation which doesn't say what is a market economy. A market existed in many societies, and it doesn't use the term capitalism. In fact, it's a generalization of market. It is market, capital market, transformation of the money, the capital, the transformation of production of goods and services, of course, against all form of planification, and a core issue, a central issue, labor market, that is the complete transformation of the status of people, even if the reality of the past public or social ownership was of course complex, with integrating relationship of domination, forms of bureaucratic exploitation, what you want, but still it was not transformation of workers into commodities and wage to be under the pressure of generalized competition. So this was the program pushed forward by experts. But of course, one of the key issues was that and difficulties of that dogmatic program of generalized privatization. When you want to privatize, with what money can you buy what is to be privatized? And because of the nature of the former society and the place of money in that society, there was not a primitive accumulation of capital, of money as capital for that. So there was the question of real buyers. And that I don't go into. I have written articles on the different moments of privatization, mass privatization without money, and so on. But there was in the global process, and especially in the second phase of the transformation, the so-called transition, because of a lack of national capital, if we can move on, a specific role of international capital, which is real, and which could express, can you see something? No, it's too small, I don't know, but it. We will come back on that. It's the penetration of foreign capital through the creation of banks, of private banks. And the date, the first column expressed the date when more than 50% was foreign aid of assets in the banks was foreign owned. And you have different countries because you have different strategies. In Hungary and in the Baltic Republic, they were the first to open to foreign capital and to sell the factories to real money capital. And so already in the end of the 90s, there were more than 50% in the new banking system under foreign capital. But for all the other countries except Slovenia, it was in the 2000 that this occurred, And this occurred after the negotiation, the last negotiation of the GATT on service, which Ursula also spoke about, on the question of service. Service are many aspects, but one of the main aspects for that issue is the financial service. And so there were openings in the end of the 90s because of those international agreements on trade and services, opening to financial capital to enter the countries. And there was, so mainly in the around the perspective of integration in the European Union, the dominant and the major part of the assets being dominated, a huge part, that is more than 60%, more than 80%, up to 100%, 90% in many countries, except Slovenia, which kept still up to now under 30%. And it didn't avoid a banking crisis. So I will come back on that afterwards. So all those are, I will comment a bit later, but of course those demonstrate the because of the specificity of the transformation, the specific role, you don't have this in the southern countries, the specific role and specific weight of foreign capital in the capitalist transformation. And the last example, of course, of strong external factors and actors you had in the Yugoslavia was, of course, the visible political and military role of foreign powers in the dealing of the Yugoslav crisis, NATO. NATO bombing, that you have no equivalent possibility to imagine that dealing of a conflicting issue, for instance, between Ireland and Great Britain, or between the Basque country and Spain, a bombing, to solve what? And so that's a kind of political decision, demonstrate and a very arrogant, dominant attitude toward peripheral country, an illustration of that. You can also illustrate it in the way Dayton agreements in Bosnia were written. Who wrote the constitution? It was not only a question of stopping the war, but the constitution, and so on. And the neo and real or neo-protectorate which do exist in the Balkan are also illustration, of course, of all these issues. It works. So, second point to illustrate the real process of semi-peripherization is the symmetries within the European Union, meaning, of course, non-democratic, non-equalitarian kind of relationship. There is a semantic illustration of that. I'm always fighting against it because it's real horrible and reflects a typical peripheral relationship and arrogant neocolonial kind of attitude. That is the dominant formulation used in Eastern Europe to express the future, saying that Eastern European countries have to enter Europe as a program. So entering Europe, coming back to Europe, what does it mean? Europe, the word Europe is used like the word America has been used to describe the United States. So United States being the whole continent and European Union being the whole continent, and behind that utilization of the vocabulary Europe, there is a kind of a racist, arrogant use of the term Europe, Europe integration, saying you must not be Balkanic people, you must not be nationalist people, you must integrate the civilized Europe and enter Europe. All that is a very arrogant way also to say that there is the European Union is supposed to reflect what is civilized and a de facto system you have only to enter in without discussion. So it is a way to avoid a concrete critical discussion of institutions, of economic policies, of choices within that concrete union. And speaking of a continent, a civilization, Europe, that you have to enter. Well, there is of course a reality of a dominant role of France and German core country in the building of the former European Economic Community, which transformed it into European Union in 92-93, and determining through a direct negotiation the Maastricht Treaty in 92. It was a direct negotiation between France, dominant forces, and which were the so-called Socialist Party at that time, turning towards social liberalism, and discussing with the German power the criteria in order to convince the Germans to get rid of the Deutschmark. But those criteria were established, of course, in the kind of de facto dominant role of historical countries. I will come back on more sophisticated aspect a little bit later on. And those very same countries, that is France and Germany, were, by the way, the first not to respect what they had established as rules, that is the so-called, which has nothing to be scientific, 3% of the annual deficit, governmental fiscal deficit, not to be overcome, or 60% of public debt. Not to be. Those criteria were not respected by France and Germany, and at that time they were not considered to be experts from the euro, and so on. So the arrogant Merkozy behavior, I mean, is not to be also forgot about the way it was they were discussing the Greek crisis and so on. And of course you can imagine about the way the crisis in the southern periphery is dealt with by the Troika. You could imagine that the attitude of France or Germany receiving the Troika and the International Monetary Fund. I mean, there are these symmetries. There are these symmetries. So, another illustration of the soft power, the symmetrical, is the fact that the conditions, the criteria of integration in the European Union, called in 90, there were the so-called Copenhagen criteria in 93, elaborated by the European Commission, market economy, viable market economy, the de facto state of rule and pluralism, and then the integration of the rules of which have been voted in the Union and so on. So there were official criteria, but de facto the criteria of integration are the non-official, because what does it mean to have a viable market economy? It doesn't mean anything. De facto, so the dominant criteria are the Washington Consensus. Well, you have to be in a market economy in the sense of generalized privatization, but also a certain kind of arbitrary criteria. They can choose who have been elected. Is the one who have been elected reflects the real transformation which is expected by the dominant forces and so on. So there are non-official geopolitical criteria, and behind the geopolitical criteria, destruction of the former system, which is completely different from the southern country. and which is not donc official and which is de facto the condition of integration, including also an non-official criterion which was imposed de facto, that is the integration in NATO. In fact, there has been a kind of package deal, and people were in general in Eastern Europe convinced that they had to accept the combination of NATO to be and European Union to get together, which is of course not true. So those all dimensions reflect a very specificity of the eastern periphery, which helped NATO to expand when it had to be dissolved after the dissolution of the Warsaw Pact armies. The Yugoslav crisis has been an opportunity for the US to maintain and expand the NATO, of course, and to also to transform in a way the nature of European Union also in the dealing and Euro-Atlantic dealing of Eastern Europe and especially the Balkan and Yugoslav crisis. And of course, it has led to a specific situation of Eastern Europe experimentation in a very difficult situation because of all the confused etiquette of the past, what is socialist, what is not, and the people coming, presenting themselves as expert. Do you discuss science when you are expert in the face of you, economists to present the scientific answer, privatization and market will bring efficiency and freedom. Why would you refuse this? And so on. So, I mean, and the fact that there was no accumulation of independent trade union except in certain, so we could discuss the Polish case, and there was the exceptional transformation of the former official trade union in Slovenia, which is a specific case, but in the other cases, there was no political and trade union condition for working class, for the population to resist neoliberal recipes, which were presented as supposed to be efficient. And so the Eastern Europe, Eastern periphery has played a very specific negative vanguard role in the radical implementation of something which has not been experimented elsewhere. To give one example is the flat tax. There again, with the resistance of Slovenia, flat tax is a uniform tax, which is very unjust. Margaret Thatcher wanted to introduce a poll tax, which was in fact of the very same nature. So the poll tax was the same tax you have to pay, whatever be the income of the budget, the family, and whatever be your income. So it is very unjust. And the flat tax is the generalization. You mixed all taxes on income, on benefit, and so on in one single, and you reduce it. And it has been reduced in Eastern Europe at an historical level, very low. Through the competition, it plays a very key role for a general reduction of the taxes on capital, while there is the introduction of taxes on products, which is very unjust, because and especially when you become poorer, you have to pay the same tax when you buy some products, whatever be your income. So Eastern Europe played a very specific role in that period as a negative vanguard. Too rapidly. A new financial. Yeah. So the last point is rapidly new financial and trade dependency. And the question is that those new financial and trade dependency have been presented and perhaps perceived as positive. We are weak, we are not so much developed, so let us use the knowledge, the capacity and the capital of the developed capitalist core country, and it will bring us modernity and strength. And if you go, I have no time to go in reading too much, but if you use the reports published by the European Bank for Banque Européenne pour le Développement, for the reconstruction and development, and transition report on the transition, so-called transitional region. Before 2009, the integration, the integration of Eastern European countries within trade and financial institution of European Union was presented as an asset. Of course, there was a different period. I don't go into the detail. There were after 89, the 90s. Were a decade of first a sharp what is called systemic depression, destruction of the former system, and a very huge destruction of the former system, which was described by even the World Bank, saying that the social dimensions of the shock were leading to increase in inequality and poverty and deterioration of life expectancy and general health. The World Bank reports remind that the states of Europe and Central Asia started the process of transition with some of the lowest levels of inequality in the world, yet since then inequality has increased steadily in all transitions. So the first 10 years were years of increasing inequality, of increasing poverty in a dramatic sense, with some quote, the UNICEF Women in Transition report of 99 described that while women in the region began the transition process with a relatively good health status and adequate access to basic health services, the most clear measure of the worsening health condition throughout the region are located in date of life expectancy. Out of 23 countries for which data are available, female life expectancy decreased in 16 countries and male life expectancy in 22. In Russia, women lost 3.2 years of life expectancy and men 6.3 years, women are stronger, due to stress, poor nutrition, increased alcohol and substance abuse and job violence. Anyway, so that the first 10 years. But then came the so-called catching up, 2000s. 2000s, in different situation, of course, I don't speak in the 90s, the question of the wars, in Yugoslavia and so on. So then if we go to the 2000, there was an euphoric presentation of the changes in the international reports, and there was a period where precisely in 1999, when there was a decision to open really the door for the next European election in 2004, to eight Eastern European countries plus Malta and Cyprus, and then Bulgaria and Romania, there were an increase of foreign direct investment, especially as I showed to you in foreign in the banking system, with opening of affiliates of foreign banks, of Western banks in Eastern Europe, and the growth, and the rapid growth, which gave the euphoric feeling in the first period. Does it work? If not, no, it doesn't want to show the growth. No, I don't know why. Anyway, so I'm sorry, but the figures are quite impressive, especially the Baltic states had more than around 8, 9, 10% a year's growth. In the Balkan, Montenegro had 10% growth, and so on, Croatia, and there were more than 6% as an average growth in Eastern Europe, in the Baltic Republic higher, and in the Balkan. So the slogan and the comment were to say, trade dependency and trade integration, sorry, and financial integration have produced a strong growth and catching up the first. What does it mean, catching up? You compare the rate of GDP growth, and in the old Europe at that very same period, in the 2000, the rate of growth, the average rate of growth was 2%, something like that. So 2% here, 6% in Eastern Europe, in the Baltic Republic, in the Balkan, and so on, catching up. But catching up meaning so that a reduction of what? Of inequalities, of differences, that was the hope. Anyway, and when the crisis occurred in the US in 2007 and 2008, out of subprime banking system, national banking system, not foreign, then in Europe, the old Europe, the crisis with the huge recession, international recession in 2008, it seemed that Eastern Europe was protected, except Hungary, which began to have a low rate of growth. But the crisis arrived in. I'm sorry that it doesn't work. Anyway, so that's for the next point. So the crisis arrived in 2009, and there, I'm sorry not to show you the figure, but they are close. The countries which have the highest rate of growth, like the Baltic one, or the Montenegro, Croatia, Serbia also, and so on, had the sharpest decline, and the transition report says that even that the International Bank, that is the bird in French, which was helping privatization, the herb, and registered an historical loss of funds in 2008. And it said that the severe aspect of the economic crisis in Eastern Europe is threatening almost two decades of economic reforms. But still, in 2009, the dominant reports, by that bank, the dominant question of that bank was, the following: is the transition itself in crisis? So they were not discussing if people were, what was the situation of the economy, the social issues and so on in the crisis, but is the transition itself in crisis? That is the neoliberal model of privatization and new trade and financial dependency in crisis? In crisis, and the chief report said that in fact, first, the reforms were not put into question. Okay. Second, but there were a big fear that the foreign, what was presented as a strength, could become a weakness. That is, that the foreign banks withdraw rapidly their money. And so this report says that in fact the region generally avoided the currency collapse and the systemic banking crisis and so on did not produce what was the fear, that is a general withdrawing of the bank, but it doesn't say here that the international answer to that fear of the collapse, I spoke myself in an article of a possible tsunami, banking east-western tsunami at that time in 2009, it was a void. But why was it a void? It was a void because there was what is called in a very big secret, not big publicity, the Vienna Initiative. The Vienna Initiative was produced. Okay, I must have it. The Vienna Initiative was a coalition of banks, international banks, to try and maintain the affiliates in Eastern Europe. So altogether, there was not that a collapse, but was it a recovery after 2009? What is the situation since then? And the situation is described in the international report as very fragile and with the following formula: the impact of the global crisis is still present in many transition economies, even as a recovery took hold, a recovery now under threat from a much less benign external environment, and so on. So there is a global analysis, I cannot read it, I have no time, but that in fact, the situation is very, very weak. The very fragile recovery which existed was export-led. Export-led, what does it mean? That the growth was permitted by a slowdown, a very sharp slowdown of wages and of imports because of low demand. So that is the global austerity of the situation, which permits a certain export in a way, but its export is itself completely dependent on the capacity to really export. That is, that the country to which you export are in good position to buy your product. So the external crisis in European Union is really there. So all those aspects shows the reality of dependence. But I'm going on the second point. The integration in the core of the capitalist world system in crisis is the real issue. I think the problem is there are limitations, non-satisfactory aspects to emphasize on only peripheral relationship. So what are the real genesis and cause of the social destructions since the 80s? Secondly, it's important to deal with the European construction in a more sophisticated way. It is with its contradiction, in the internal contradiction, and even, I would say, not agreement among neoliberals on to use or not to use Europe and so on. Third, to evaluate, and that is a point important, the role of internal national actors, not only foreigners and not only external. And fourth, to understand the complex set of new historical periods and combined crises. So rapidly, these four points. About the genesis of the real complete disintegration, to come back on the first report which was made by Ilio Sula, I would say that there is a combination of periods. At the root of a neoliberal answer was a crisis of profitability in the 70s in the real core capitalist countries, and combined with the crisis of the world order, decolonization, the increasing movement against all forms of dominations and so on. And the conservative counter-revolution, that is a neoliberal answer, which was an offensive against all gains which came under the pressure, which was described in the first report, under the pressure of bipolar world, the gains for the workers, and the reduction of inequalities in the core countries in that period, and so on, and increasing wages, and so on. Now the program for the neoliberals was to treat workers as commodities again in a radical way, and to decrease the share of the way of wages in the added value, and for United States to reconquest also its hegemony in the world. So social attacks began. I was speaking of Margaret Thatcher. Go and see the picture of Ken Loach, the attacks against trade unions and so on. So what is true is that the general, like Ursula said, the generalization of the neoliberal program and the radicalization of neoliberal program occurred after 89, but the beginning, the roots of the neoliberal program was in the 80s, and it began in the core countries with the destruction of trade union forces, with the destruction of the code of the beginning of the destruction of the code of labor there, and so on. So that is the point with the U.S. international counter-offensive using international negotiation, Uruguay round, to find a new space for accumulation in services and international new market, like it was said before, and developing the banking system, financial system in the world. Then occurred 99 as a radicalization of that, which permitted it to integrate within the program of neoliberal counter-revolution, if we say, a real counter-revolutionary dimension, that is the criminalization of a revolution, a concrete offensive against all social gains being identified as Bolshevik gulag, and so on, and a strong radicalization of the liberal offensive. But second point, there is the European construction, which is to be debated and understood also, to deepen the understanding of its internal contradiction, not to reduce the question of relationship between core and periphery. The European construction was at different phase, of course, and in the after the Second World War, Great Britain was not in it, and there was an alternative between free trade zone or building something else, and building something else after the war, so with political aim and within it in the negotiation between France and Germany, but also no consensus on the nature of institution. De Gaulle, the French De Gaulle, refuse to build a federal kind of union. So there were conflicts within the different bourgeoisie, within the European community. Yeah? But then there is different phase. And when there was the international crisis of the international monetary system in 71, there were also in the 70s attempts to build a monetary system in Europe with the ECU. But there was also something which is different from a NAFTA, for instance, that is from a free zone, a parliament which was introduced, which of course is which was not a complete, which is not at all a real democratic institution, not legislative power, but still a contradiction because it's open to politics. It's open to elections and it became open to direct elections in 79. And then in the 80s, speaking of the south and periphery, after when the Greek, Portugal and Spain coming out of dictatorship were to enter the European community, there was an increase of the budget of the union to help to win them to that Europe, to that capitalist Europe. So that is why also entering Europe is more popular in the southern country than perhaps in northern country and in other parts of the Euro. And there were up to 85 a control of flow of capital. It was not free. So there is a new phase after 86. From 86 to 98, a new phase which combined the neoliberal turn in France in particular, but in general, with the negotiation of the Single Act, which opens the union, the new community, European community, to free flow of capital. And in between, there is the fall of the Berlin Wall, which was not foreseen. And then it radicalized something which was not foreseen, that is that Germany as a contributor to the budget didn't want to pay for the integration of the other Eastern European country after the integration of Eastern Germany as much. So there was a trend to opposite to the trend which was implemented in a limited way, but still implemented when thousand countries entered the Union. There were at that time an increased budget to reduce some inequalities, but when Eastern European countries enter, there was the contrary, the decision, especially in France and Germany, which was a political decision. It is not in the treaty, a political decision to limit the European budget to 1% of the GDP of the Union, and it is again in the recent negotiation for the 7 years budget a new, even less than 1%. That is when you enlarge to countries which need more budgets, more funds, more structural funds to help, and so on, there is on the contrary a reduction of budget. That is a trend to transform the Union into free trade and to put the emphasis not on funds, on budget, on public funds and state funds, but on foreign capital, on free flow of capital, on foreign direct investment. And when you put the emphasis on foreign direct investment, you have to attract foreign direct investment. How do you attract foreign direct investment? You must reduce tax on that, on capital, and refuse to protect wages to be attractive. And then you introduce another rule, a de facto pressure of a budget equilibrium. If you have less resources, tax resources, then there is the pressure to reduce the expenses. on social issues. So there is a general trend of radical destruction of social benefits and positive benefit for the capital. And then the last period was 1993. In 1999, in fact, it was 10 years after 89. It was the balance sheet of the peaceful transition was not a positive, increasing disillusion, going towards the south instead of going towards the north, increasing a difficulty for neoliberal parties in Eastern Europe to have the minimum percentage to go back in parliament even, difficulty to build coalitions, increasing right-wing currents anti-European. So the openings to integrate, I spoke of non-official criteria, the decision to integrate the countries was not because of a successful transition. It was because the transition was difficult, and in order to help the liberal parties to convince the population to accept the burden, with the hope that it will be a little bit better within the Union than and staying outside. So, and secondly, there was also the balances of the NATO war, with a very unstable situation in the Balkan, in fact, and not at all a stabilization. So there was also in 1999 that proposal to the Western, what is called the Western Balkan, that is ex-Yugoslav Republic, except Slovenia, which is always, which was always a candidate and then member, plus Albania, to have a European future, to use again the same formulation. So this was the combination of a rush forward and an enlargement, not stable at all, not controlled, not stable, but in a situation of transforming the European Union to Euro-Atlantic with NATO, a kind of a structure, and more free market, and more towards free competition, salvage, wild competition. And okay, but with this illusion of a small face in the 2000 I described, I have no the figures, of a catching up and of the positive assets of that perspective. But collapsing after 2008 with the crisis which occurred in the 2009 and up to now, not a real recovery. So then a third point rapidly, which we have also to integrate in the debate, both in southern country, in the core country, and in the Eastern European countries, everywhere, that is the role of I have no time to perhaps in the discussion I'll come on the contradiction of European construction. This I said it. The role of the actors, the national actors. Anyway, the need to evaluate the role of national actors, and then the combined crisis. That is the need, the fact that you cannot have only external actor which implement the policy. You have to have internal actors. So there has to be, either it is called a comprador bourgeoisie, which is sold to foreigners, or it is a real national bourgeoisie. And you can have a very neoliberal policy being outside the Euro, outside the European Union, and implementing those very same recipes. Even the Slovenian case, with its limits, shows that even under the pressure of external powers, you can have some form of resistance to what kind of tax, what kind of trade union, what kind of political economy, what kind of politics. So it is difficult if it is isolated. So the lack of coordination for resistance to dominant criteria, for instance, of all Eastern European countries or of Balkan treaty countries, are an element of weakness to be independent and to have the possibility to have a say. But this is also the choice of actors, of national actors. And you can compare what occurred, you know that very well, during the Second World War, where there were international actors, including Stalin, in Yalta agreements, which were trying to impose, for instance, to Yugoslavia to stay as a kingdom and in the peripheral part of the capitalist country, and not to have a real social revolution. And so, I mean, there is the possibility. Cuba is also an example, very small country. You can even resist to the dominant pressure of foreign imperialist position if you have the support of your population. And you cannot have the support of your population if that population is not self-organized and have the political, democratic possibility to judge what are the issue. So to finish, that's a point for discussion. In fact, we really have to deal with a completely new historical period with several combined crises that, of course, I cannot develop. The first one, which is not the topic here, but which is absolutely important for our understanding, is the historical limits of the planet, submitted to unlimited capitalist destruction of natural and human resources. So the combination of the capitalist crisis and with the ecological, environmental dimensions, and we have in Europe also a certain responsibility. At what level do you implement an ecological transition? Is it only on a national level that you can do this? Okay. There is, secondly, a crisis of neoliberal financial globalization, but as it was said in the first report, I agree totally with Ursula on that. The problem is because of the relationship of forces, international relationship of forces, and the very big weakness of trade union resistance, political resistance for the moment. The crisis of neoliberal policy in the banking system and the incapacity to really satisfy fundamental needs has led to a new phase which is ongoing and in the European construction, a new phase which is not a turn like in after the 30s or after the Second World War towards a New Deal or neo-Keynesian politics, which is not at all the stake now, it's not feasible. It is a new offensive where the capitalist system, a neoliberal system, is explicitly using strong institutions, strong states, not the market alone, strong states, non-elected institutions, the Troika, the Bank, World Bank, the Central Bank, the IMF, and the European Commission, and so on, to impose in constitutions, even with the so-called golden rule of equilibrium, austerity. So the capitalist system as a whole in core countries and very foreign countries in the world is no more promising more well-being and democracy. It is asking for austerity and respecting discipline and the rule imposed by a constitution and non-elected bodies. So there is a very specific issue which raised the question of Margaret Thatcher said there is no alternative, Is there an alternative? I do believe there is. That is for the discussion, of course. And it raised what was said at the end of the first report. That is the issue, what was said, socialism or barbarie. Barbarie is more and more here. And not only in peripheries, and even saying the periphery, I mean, you have now the so-called new emergent countries like China, Russia, and so on, who are not progressive. But we are in a better situation than the core countries. So we are in a completely new historical phase. What is at stake is to resist that international competition for austerity, non-democracy, and destruction of even fundamental rights for human beings. So we have to resist this. Okay. Sorry to be long.